Outpost in the Burbs and Montclair State University with the UK band Strawbs, up next on Carpe Diem. Hello and welcome to Carpe Diem. I'm Amanda Eustice. Music has a way of bringing people together like no other art. And Outpost in the Burbs in Montclair, New Jersey provides a special community for people to do just that. We recently visited Outpost where we had the pleasure of sitting down with Board of Trustees member Al Mercuro to talk about what makes them such a rare and exceptional organization.
A volunteer with Outpost in the Burbs for almost two decades, Al shares his favorite aspects of working with the organization.
The most interesting thing is the community outreach we do beyond just the concerts. The fact that we're all volunteers, we're basically here to help bring music to town, but at the same time, hopefully some of the money that we do raise in the work that we do does go to food banks and soup kitchens and things like that. So that part of it's extremely rewarding. I think because the Outpost has been around for over 31 years now, we try to offer a fairly inexpensive way to see national acts coming into town in an intimate setting. I've often said this, and it may sound odd, that we're the best kept secret in town. Someplace that's not like an arena or a stadium, someplace that, again, they feel pretty close to the music, and I think most of the audience will feel that when they leave. My favorite part, it may sound odd, is the sound check. I find that kind of energy to be exciting to see how it all gets set up, and you kind of get a better sense of the musicians that are playing and the issues that they have and things like that to deal with.
Tonight's sound check is for the Strawbs, a band that's very special to Al as they go back a long way.
Lay down, lay me down.
1973. It was the first time I would listen to WAW-FM, so I would hear this one song constantly that I loved. 6 months later, a friend of mine from CW Post College out in Long Island invites me to a concert out there to see this band from overseas, and as I'm walking in, I hear that song, and it was Straub's opening for Slade. That's how I found out that's the band that did that song that I really love. So about, I guess, 6 months after that, I was booking shows at Montclair State at the time as a student, and I was able to arrange them to perform at Montclair State at the same time. That was March of 74.
So I have the extreme pleasure of doing what I did 45 years ago and introducing Strawbs.
The Outpost is known for booking very unique performers, one of which is the classic UK band Strawbs. Starting as a bluegrass group in the early 1960s, the Strawbs' progressive and folk rock songs gives them a sound that has kept them vital for over 50 years. Bandleader Dave Cousins gives us the insight on how the band started and how he's led them to success throughout the years.
This is the opening track of the album, Grave New World.
Hi, I'm Dave Cousins of the Strawbs. I've been the leader of the band since we first started out as the Strawberry Hill Boys back in the mid-1960s. We were first of all Britain's first bluegrass band. I was playing banjo and we were playing American songs like the Blue Ridge Mountain Blues. But the most influential thing about the music that I play is that I listened to very early on a lot of Americana, probably from the Harry Smith collection. And I listened to that, and I listened to old banjo players, Appalachian Mountain banjo players. And I was playing the banjo, and I realized that they were playing in modal tunings. So I started to put my banjo in modal tunings. Then I put the guitar in modal tunings, and suddenly a whole new world opened. And now I write lots of songs in various different tunings. And people, that's probably been my downfall, because people who want to play my songs can't work out how the heck I do it. So never mind, But that's how it really happened, how it started, and how I am now.
There is hate in your eyes.
The longevity of the band at Strawbs is the fact that people who come in, we never ever ask a new musician who comes in to play exactly what the one played before. So everybody who comes in brings something fresh and new to the band, and we've always rejuvenated ourselves. And so that's been one of the functions of the band. But the real longevity of the band is in the lyrics of the songs, because people identify with them very personally. They may not necessarily get the exact meaning that they had when I wrote the songs, perhaps, or when somebody else wrote the songs. But nonetheless, people identify with the songs. And we've had many, many people when we've been on tour who come up after the show, couples come up and say, "We got married to one of your songs." And it's really flattering. They say, "Oh, we had our first dance to one of your songs," or we walked up the aisle to one of your songs. And it's the last part of a piece called Autumn that we do. And it's very flattering to think that people who are celebrating perhaps the most important day of their lives are celebrating it with our music. And that really is the two factors of the longevity of the band, the fact that we refresh all the time with new players, and the fact that the lyrics of the songs people can identify with.
Strawbs are made up of five members that each bring their talents together to make the sounds of the 1960s fit right into present day. This past April, the Strawbs performed at Outpost in the Burbs, and we got a chance to talk with the band members as well as capture their performance. Here's a look at two of their songs as well as the reflections from the other four members of Strawbs.
Lay down, lay me down. Lay down, lay me down. Lay down, lay me down for my soul.
I was actually brought into the band to change the band. That was the reason I was brought in, because the band was a folk band up until that point, and Dave sort of envisaged the band had a potential to be a stadium type band. So I was brought in on electric guitar, and it evolved pretty much the way we hoped it would. We started introducing the long pieces with different sections and things. And it's pretty much unchanged since then, apart from the quality of the sound, of course. Technically, it's evolved more probably than musically, because we hit a pretty much a potential point in terms of style, I think, in the early 70s.
Yeah, yeah, that'd be true. Well, I think the business-wise, it's changed drastically. I'm sure both remember lots of classic people who were involved on the business side of music going back to the 70s, and lots of people did it for the love of it. There were some rascals out there, and some there were used car salesmen that sort of tried their hand at music, maybe. But a lot of them did it very passionately, and they really cared about it, and they wanted to see things change and happen. And I think now the music business is probably more run by accountants than anything else. You know, I mean, the record companies aren't what. It's not. You don't get record companies like you used to in those days. When we signed to A&M, you know, they wouldn't sign you if they didn't have a bit of a long-term plan, and they would give you, you know, a bit of time, a few albums, even a few years to sort of progress and do things. And now it's kind of, you sense for a lot of the young artists, it's like, do it now or it's all over, you know? And it's kind of hard to work on, and it's not so supportive, I think, of the artist anymore. I mean, I've got nothing against sort of computer-driven music, but there's nothing like seeing someone there with a guitar singing a song, and you just go, "Wow, what a, you know, fantastic voice!" And the meaning of the song just comes through them.
It's getting harder and harder, unfortunately, in this day and age. You know, unless you're actually a songwriter, someone who can actually create something yourself as drummers, you don't normally do that so much, so it becomes quite difficult. Dave's in a different situation. He writes, you know, he plays guitar, he plays keyboards, he does all sorts of things. He's far too clever. Does arrangements, you know. So for Dave, it's a slightly different thing. But for young kids coming up, you've got to be so talented now, and it's so hard to get out there and get on that musical ladder. It's not easy.
Yeah, there are a lot less venues than when we were, you know, in our formative years, and there were loads of places to play, pubs and small venues and clubs and that, and a lot of those have closed down, so it definitely is harder. But I think one thing that aspiring artists can do is try and diversify into different areas these days. I mean, for example, quite a few of the drummers I know now have their own studios, so as well as playing in bands on the road, they can record their own drums and send them to people on the internet, and stuff like that. So it's just finding ways to kind of pursue your dream, but make it a, you know, practical thing as well financially.
Because if you really are committed to doing something in music, then you have to follow that dream. I followed that dream. I was told, you get a job. That's what I was told. Get a job. You need a trade. You need to be an electrician or a plumber. I don't want to be a plumber or electrician. I want to be a drummer. You know. Well, that doesn't earn you regular money, but I followed the dream, and it worked.
Well, it's given me, I can't do anything else, so it's given me a reason to be. I don't have any other skills, a lot of interest, but no other tremendous skills as such. So it's just my total expression, my way of being, it's music.
Yeah. And that would be the same thing, I think, what Dave just said at the end there. It gives you a vehicle to express something, you know, emotions, you know, and in terms of writing is quite important. It's a lot comes out from there, doesn't it, Dave?
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
I think we all sort of write rather than some people might write mathematically or in a formatted way, you know. I think with Strawbs it's more of a kind of an expression from within, and so music does give you that opportunity to do that, really. That's been rewarding from that point of view.
I mean, being able to do something you love and earn a living from it is quite a thing in itself. It gives you the opportunity to work with some fabulous musicians from, you know, some wonderful people, and travel the world, see places you might never ever get to in a normal life. So music has been very good to me. I've been doing it 50 years now. It's a long, long time, and I have no regrets at going into it. There are times when it's quite hard because you're not always working, of course. It doesn't always work out that you're earning good money. Sometimes you have to do other things to supplement your income, but music is just so satisfying, it's so rewarding, it's such a buzz.
At the age I'm at now, I still just love getting out on stage in front of the audience and playing. I get a great kick out of it. As long as that's there, and as long as my arms and legs still work, I'll carry on doing it.
Next, I'll be speaking with another Armist performing at Outpost. First, let's hear her performing her new song, Don't Spill My Margarita. Here's Amy Rigby.
I'm a lover and a fighter. I'm a mother and a reader. And I've earned a little R&R, so don't spill my margarita. Dumped Catholicism, tried yoga. I dug that dude the Bhagavad Gita. I made a few sips from enlightenment now, so don't spill my margarita. Don't spill my margarita. Give me salt, give me lime, give me time to catch a buzz. They say tequila is as tequila does. Peace, I've been stressed. I want more, I don't want less. I need to get low down in an immaculate white cotton dress. Left to do. Does a cold drink in the hand beat a hot papa, mamacita? Don't spill my margarita. Don't spill my margarita. If I go all Jimmy Buffett, can I still be Townsend Pete? Don't spill my margarita. Don't spill my margarita.
Oh, what a great song. Joining me now is Amy Rigby. Now, that song is just so catchy. I love it. Where did the idea come for it?
Well, I went to Mexico for the first time about 2 months ago. I was playing at a guitar festival, and I had just arrived, and everyone was in their like flowy clothes, suntanned. I was like in black and boots and like pale from being in a New York winter, mm-hmm. and everyone was like, oh, come on, chill out, relax, you know, and I just was like, well, I gotta get a drink. So I'm like waiting to go on and play, and I had a margarita, and I set it down on the ground, and then like some woman went by, and I was like, don't spill that, and then I was like, oh, that's a song, and I just like wrote it right sitting there while I was waiting to play my set, you know, wrote down all the words, yeah. and then like went back to my hotel room later that night, and just like wrote the chords, and I wanted it to have like that real kind of like relaxed, beachy vibe, which I have never written a song like that before, but I just was like feeling this yeah. whole like Mexico. Anyway, so.
Well, you said R&R in it, right?
R&R.
A little R&R.
I know, I was like, I never knew why people go on vacation. Now I understand.
Exactly.
It's this, right?
So this is your newest album, mm-hmm. right? The Old Guys. Now, how is it different from the other albums you've released in the past?
I made a bunch of solo albums back in the 90s, 2000s, and then I got together with another musician. We started making music together, touring together, and he and I made three albums together. Oh, did I say we got married? No, okay.
No. Wow,
and
yeah, that was in
and
there
his
somewhere.
Name's Reckless Eric, and so we were Reckless Eric and Amy Rigby, made oh. three records together, and I just like, I don't know, I guess I learned a lot from the stuff we did together, and you know, he produced this record like he did the three that we made together. And I just got really comfortable working with him. It's probably like a harder sound than some of my other records. And, you know, I think it's like harder times that we live in. So the world changed, I changed and the world changed. And also I think like when I made my earlier solo albums, there was still kind of what seemed like a music business, which doesn't really exist that much anymore. So I think like artistically, it is my most sort of honest album. I feel like I wasn't really aspiring to anything with it, just trying to make an artistic statement. So I feel proud of that.
Now, tell me a little bit about your singer-songwriter career. What made you go into this industry or even want to write?
Well, I started as a visual artist, and I went to Parsons School of Design in New York and thought I was going to be an illustrator or do something like that, but it just happened to be the late 70s. It just happened to be like CBGB's punk and just this amazing like creative freedom going on in New York City, because New York City was like such a mess then. Everything, you know, there were just like abandoned cars everywhere. The trash was never picked. You know, it was a hellhole. But it was just like, you know, it was great. It was cheap, and it was, and there were just these incredible people playing music that I got to see every night. And so that kind of, my parents weren't happy, but like I sort of swerved towards pursuing music. I was a fan. I was at a lot of shows, and then just started to write songs. Started a band with one of my brothers who followed me to New York. We grew up in Pittsburgh, and because we were living in an apartment building, we played acoustic instruments, and we were at that point. Punk was sort of over, and we were getting into old country records, and so we could like keep our rehearsals kind of quiet on these acoustic instruments, so the neighbors wouldn't like pound on the floor, and at the time I was reading a lot of Southern writers, and I loved just the details of like everyday lives, and I loved that in country music, so that kind of gave me a window, like a little way that, oh, like I can write songs, and I'll learn to play as I go along, sure. But I want to get, you know, I just want to communicate these songs to people. And so it kind of just followed on from there. I played in bands for a while. It took me a while to be, you know, I was kind of shy, and like to get up by myself and play just like took me, you know, a couple years. But I had a kid, and I felt like time's running out, and any time that I spend away from my daughter, like I feel like it has to add up to something. So I kind of was like, I gotta do this now. And that was when I made my first solo album in 1996 called Diary of a Mod Housewife. And it was about like being a mom and trying to be an artist, and just the, you know, it's not easy to do either of those things, and to try to make a living. And so it just kept on from there. You know, it's not something I started out wanting to do, but it's something I needed to do and have continued to need to write songs, perform them for people.
Well, let me ask you this. Do you feel like you fulfilled both the mom side and parenting side of things, and
ask
also
my daughter,
your...
She's 30 now. I hope that she's, you know, I hope, you know, I feel like, yeah, she's like a great person, and I feel like I kept going, and she loves music, she plays music. You know, it hasn't been easy, you know, and I'm sure, you know, there were times when she was like, Mom, can't you just be normal and like get a normal job? And her dad is a musician too, so you know, she had that. He's a drummer, so she had that to deal with.
Sure.
But I think, you know, it gave her like an interesting life for sure. And I can't imagine like having not been a mother. That gave me so much inspiration. So that was like really huge in my life. I feel so lucky that I got to do both.
Go through both. Now, what do you feel is just the most rewarding thing in terms of music that you've done? Most rewarding memory?
Well, I have to say it was meeting my husband. Because I loved his music. And I used to cover one of his songs. And he's English. And the promoter in this little town in the north of England heard me playing this song that he wrote. And he was like, you know, he wrote that song here in this town. And so he kind of put us together on a show. And it turned out like that first show we did together was like the first room he'd ever played that song in.
Wow.
So it just felt like very magic. Yeah. And, you know, to get to play with him and work with him.
Now, is there any other advice that you'd give to upcoming artists or songwriters?
I guess, you know, really, you know, I think part of what was so great in the beginning was getting to like play with friends and like work with, and all along, I mean, yes, a lot of times you got to get up there and do it by yourself, but just getting to work with people and be open to, you know, other writers, players, singers, and you know, I think you can learn so much from everybody. And and also just like try to be honest about like who you are. And I think that probably took me a while, like to figure, well, I think Dolly Parton said like, figure out who you are and do it on purpose. Mm-hmm. And you know, that can take a while because you think like, oh, I should, you know, it can be hard for women. You think you're supposed to look a certain way. You're supposed mm-hmm. to come across a certain way. You know, maybe you're inclined to be a people pleaser anyway, because, you know, that's how, you know, maybe it's not as bad as it was like when I was growing up, which was, you know, still like the hangover of the 50s, you know, like where, you know, women wore white gloves and weren't allowed to wear like pants, you know, to work or to school. I mean, that's amazing to think like women couldn't go to college or even have like a checking account of their own, you know. So like things, you know, I think
have been changing, right?
Things have been changing. So just kind of like, please yourself, you know,
of course.
And that'll, you know, that'll work for other people.
Unfortunately, we are out of time. But thank you for joining us today. If you would like more information about this or any other edition of Carpe Diem, you can write to us on the email address on your screen, carpediem@mail.montclair.edu, or call us at 973-655-5158. For Carpe Diem, I'm Amanda Eustice. Thanks for watching. Mm-hmm.